May I come to Mr. Raghunath Mahapatra to give his opening comments before, and after that maybe I'll come to Mr. Manoj Vasa once again for a very, very pertinent, I would say, sharing of his outlook on the whole sector and making it more successful. Mr. Mahapatra, please.
I have been associated with mostly the grid connected large capacity utility scale. And I have seen the evolution of the sector since when it started. Is it audible now?
Yeah.
Okay. So, having seen that, there are two things, just opening remark I would, I think that's what, I mean, one is the grid-mounted kind of thing, which are mostly policy-driven, and entire sector is policy-driven, but some amount of things that Sanjeev was saying in AMPLUS, it's a different sector. You can go to them and have a negotiation and have a tariff, have a different kind of contract, and then take it up. You need not be guided by government other than the permissions, net metering, and other things. If you don't exceed the limit of that 1 megawatt or a different state sector. The second thing, from a point of view, this way the sector is maturing now, is that we understand, but then there is a sustainable development goals that we have to meet. The INDCs that we have submitted, we have to at a national level. So while policy can take it to that far, possibly the next level has to be the C&I is one which will go. And C&I, so you can talk, but what we have seen is there is a resistance from the DISCOMs because their revenue is going away, cross-subsidy part is going away, that they have to fund from elsewhere, and which the state is not funding from the budget. So possibly from the access and security point of view, it might be worthwhile to look at the off-grid, the rooftops, not C&I, but the other sectors which are very, very granulated, but probably that will be there. Then the IT-driven platforms which are coming in, like virtual power stations, probably a bit of aggregation. And on the supply side, I'm not talking about funding because with the Europe is there, all the people are there, but for supply side material, we are saying we are extremely dependent on China. If China decides that we will go 60 gigawatt 1 year, then the module prices will firm up by 20%. And then, given the time, door to door time between your bidding and the kind of time you get the module at the last and fag end of the projects, sometimes it becomes difficult to get. And the policy uncertainties of the SGD, anti-dumping duty, trying to protect, not having the capacity, the investment, the whole ecosystem is evolving. And it will evolve slowly, but it will slowly move towards more granulated, more diversified, and integrated.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Mr. Manoj Vasa, if you would like to add something, and then, so I'm sure you people are noting your questions in the meanwhile, because whatever, if you can send those questions over, it will help us bring those very, very pertinent questions for the answering by the esteemed panelists. Mr. Manoj Vasa.
Being part of the government, it's a responsibility to set up projects which are strong and which give comfort to the developer and also the lenders. This is a conscious attempt that we have made in all of our projects. That is why we take our pre-bid very seriously. I mentioned in my initial comments about the industry risk tender that we are bringing out. So we had a pre-bid in Delhi, I think last week, on 9th, we had a pre-bid. So a comment came that 40 megawatt is too high for the developers to take up on rooftops. Even I had personally thought that as it's in one location, Bundesliga, it might not be a challenge. But the view was expressed by almost all the big developers that 40 megawatt might be too high. So we are now fundamentally restructuring the tender in light of those comments. Another issue that we devils, the developers and the lenders, is payment security. So we have developed an elaborate three-tier payment security mechanism in Riva. The first tier is LC, as it is in most projects. The second tier and the third tier are rather interesting. The second is the Payment Security Fund. The Payment Security Fund developed by SECI is through a budgetary allocation from the government. Now, being from the government, I realize that that's a waste of government allocations to keep our money in a bank account waiting for some default to happen and then to use it. So, we have developed a payment security fund based entirely on market principles with IRIDA. The simple principle behind this being that the punitive rate of delayed payment in the PPA is higher, and the interest that IRIDA charges for its working capital loan sort of thing is lesser. So, whenever there is a default or situation of a default, we would just tap IRIDA for its working capital loan, pay on behalf of the DISCOM. The DISCOM would make a saving because what they have to pay is lower than their late payment surcharge. Furthermore, it can also be used for making early payment, take early payment rebate. Even in the industry DESCO tender that we are talking about, we have developed a payment security where MP Industrial Development Corporation, who owns the land on whose land the industries are located, they have given a payment assurance that if the industry does not pay to the solar developer, then MPIDC would recover the funds as if they were its own dues. So the short point being that I think it's a collaborative process between the bidders and the project development authorities, who should increasingly interact to give stronger projects where the risks are reduced. I mean, coming from the government, I can say a typical government attitude is that put all the risk on the developer. Obviously, if you put all the risk on the developer, he loads it onto the price. So it's best to reduce the risk, and secondly, have a appropriation of risk between the developer, procurer, and so on. For example, Riva project, in which Gaurav is supplying. Delhi Metro was very keen that the supply delivery point should be at Delhi. We had insisted that it should be at Riva, and it was proved correct because later there was a problem with the ISTS charges. Earlier, the understanding was that there would be no ISTS charges. So, if we had agreed to the delivery point being Delhi, then the projects would simply not have happened, or there have been huge litigation. They wouldn't have remained viable at all. So, it was proved to be a correct decision in hindsight that we insisted on the delivery point being Riva, and the project perhaps has lived to survive because of that decision. I think that's a long list, but that's a short point being there. Please.
Thank you so much, sir. So I think with that, what we will like to do now is maybe I have chosen some few important themes, and I have also gathered the impressions of all the critical challenges and critical requirements that the developers, the World Bank people, all of us have brought out on various issues. I've added them into the list. So the five basic themes that I wish to discuss, and I will throw it open for panelists to comment upon, include the off-takers, the bids, the land and the evacuation, and especially the transmission network and the related possibilities of disruptions as we see along, and the government policies. I think Mr. Manoj Srivastava was also referring to it very kindly. That so I will just give one line opening comment on each one as we go along, but I would like to start with the government policy itself. Lot of us have seen that in spite of robust policies and in spite of a clear focus that government has had on building not only the stated mission of 175 gigawatt, but upping it up to 227 gigawatt, we do see at various points of time some kind of, I would say, tinkerings here and there. And I would like to point out that the ECB policy and its related matters, the safeguard duty that was brought in, all the people. So we have all of us, have had our comments on that. So maybe I would like to start with the first issue, the government policy. And if you still keep coming up with your questions, keep sending them over to us so that we can include it in the discussion also. But let me say on government policy, if somebody or one of the panelists has a view, you could please give your comments there. And I would want that to be deliberated first. So anyone, if you have a view, so especially you see it from a World Bank's angle, so.
Two things come to mind. One, with partners like MPN and NRED, we've reached early agreement on how to handle issues around policy. For example, in my opening remarks, I talked about land becoming a constraint. If we look at the incidence of solar insolation on that country's total geographic area, there is going to be a constraint. Only states like Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, where the density is lower, will we be able to go out and have A, forward-looking policies where land is made available in large pools, and B, where there is sufficient interest from developers of all views that are here and others in the market. So that is something where consistent policy, and I'm very happy to have partnered with MP on this, because their land policy allows for some high level of confidence that the bank would, in anticipation of implementation of that policy, generate amongst ourselves. So we were confident that when we were financing projects in, for example, Madhya Pradesh, we would not have to face issues on which our management, we're owned partly by Government of India, so this is, our management includes one arm of the Government of India, the Ministry of Finance owns some part of the World Bank, just as a clarification, are actually being informed about how well the policies are making sure that constraints such as land, which are a subject of much heartburn in projects which require large land areas in India, have been taken care of. So that is one policy area where I believe some very good work has been done in India. It can be done only in slightly land surplus places, but at least we now have the opening to do this over time. So that is one policy I believe that will have a very, very profound implications on all renewable energy, but especially solar, because the wind power, at least location, the footprint is much smaller. So that is one thing that I wanted to say. On pricing, I do not have that bigger view, because I believe that it is eventually, as Mr. Shwastha was saying in his side, once risks are distributed in line with the capacities of people to hold that risk or manage that risk, pricing will eventually reflect some level of balance. It may be directed by government policy to a certain extent, but in the end, if it is not lifeline energy, then prices will follow market conditions for sure. So I don't think that big a policy vacuum exists on pricing. On environmental and implications of getting thousands of acres of land under a particular land use where it was not existent previously, solar has a huge advantage because it can be mounted onto frames and stuff like that. So, and it has no moving parts. Both these make it a much easier problem to tackle. We still have to think about what alternative uses of land there may be and what alternative energy storage would allow these systems to become more balanced and put out energy when it is needed. But that is something which will come in after we have. We cannot divide zero into many parts, no? The answer will always be a zero. So when we have sufficient surplus, we can talk about it. But that is my view on policy.
So simply, I just wanted to add something on the policy side across the three areas. So see, at the higher level, like setting up a goal to take it to 227 gigawatt and all that is fine, but the issue is actually in the details. And although, I mean, we saw with the change in the minister that happened around 18 months back, things have really slowed down. But I will just focus on some positive aspects. So on the rooftop side, on the government side, because we were also one of the winners in the NPU in a little bit, and I would say what Mr. Srivastava team did in that bid is actually converting a high-level policy into something in which people can actually feel comfortable to bid as low prices as we did, because We did that because it was really very well structured. For example, in a rooftop bid, if you go to SECI and all, they ask you to basically go and bid a price and then you go and discover the, because it's an engineered product and you cannot predict the sort of the cost without actually seeing the roofs and everything. And the payment security is not there. You're left alone to actually go and transact with the individual body. So it doesn't make sense for us. So the MPUNL bid is actually in a way should be a model that perhaps even SECI can follow. And I think so now Assam, I think so, is trying to follow the same kind of structure. And that is actually, that is why the entire proof of the success is that that actually led to the lowest prices, and that is actually also leading to implementation. I know for sure that we are actually already building the projects. I know Azure is already building the projects. So that is where actually it is sort of got right. So on that side, that's a success story. Similarly, on the open access and the CNI business where we are in. So it is a state subject, and people obviously, I mean, states will have an independent view because they think that some of the high paying customers have been taken out. But at the end of the day, every state is also vying to get industry into the state. And for the industry, one of the largest operating costs is the power cost. So you cannot restrict the industry to discover a lower operating cost and become more sustainable. So it is against the free market principles, essentially, and against the open access in spirit. So there also, again, certain states have taken a lead and tried to create a policy. For example, in UP, what we saw is that they defined a very clear policy in which certain substations will be allocated for open access power plants, where we can put large power plants, get connected, and you don't have to hunt for that. And also, to weed out the non-serious players, they said that you need to have power purchase agreements. Otherwise, people just set up connectivities and sort of make a profit by selling it off. So they defined a time period in which you actually have to also sign up the PPAs, because otherwise you'll be sort of squatting on connectivities. So that's a good method that they did. On the utility scale, obviously the SECI thing works, and as long as it's back to back. But we started and we went slow on the utility, because for example in some of the discoms like Telangana. Now when we went in, it was supposedly a good discom. Now, I mean, because of elections and all, if their payments are behind by 8 months, I mean, and the experience is that when we, for our private customers, we get paid within 7 days. Whereas in discoms, it takes 8 months. So, I mean, that's why the entire focus sort of for us is moved gradually towards CNI. So something has to be done from like the kind of thing that Mr. Srivastava was explaining in terms of the IRIDA working up line and all. Something, they should follow the model of MP and do it in other states. That will actually solve a lot of issues.
Oh, I agree. I think MP has really set up a model there for others to take it forward. And I really compliment Mr. Manoj Srivastava and his, under his leadership, the team that has worked on that. So I think if on the policy front, something that some of you people may have faced on some issues related therein, specific, I would still invite some more comments.
Sure. I think no doubts about it. MP, starting with Reva, really set up one of the best PPAs in India, and a lot of I think learnings have been taken and tried to replicate to the best possible extent other states have been able to do. Even SECI today, you know, the sort of payment security mechanism they are trying to get, they are proposing us an LC followed by a payment security fund of 3 months from the DISCOM, and third is a sovereign state guarantee, which is a tripartite guarantee between RBI, central government and state government, which is forming a part of all the PSAs today. It has to be still seen whether these are signed payment security funds are made, these have to be executed and made available, which is very important. Whereas like in Reva, we got the guarantee issued directly from the state government to the developer, which was a very good thing and done in time. Again on land, I think Reva set up that if there are first of all it's a solar park, but if there are delays in handover of land, those delays are passed on and you get an extension of timeline, which was very important, which was also good. then you know many times evacuation infrastructure may not be available. You know, when we bid, we consider availabilities because these are all at 400 kVs eventually. We are assuming availabilities as high as 99.8 or 99.9%. So again, Reva had a very good, Reva PP had a very good principle where, you know, beyond 50 hours of grid downtime, there is compensation available to the developers. So I think that is still not come into other SECI or NTPC PPAs. This is one thing which one should look at. So these are some of the, I would say, PPA specific things. I think one of the very big concerns today for solar, although you know solar, we all talk about solar, is much easier to do from an availability, from an insulation, from general applicability. But the risks which developers are facing are huge. The biggest one of the biggest risks is forex. Yeah, our 70% of imports are in USD, which is panels. You know, the forex moves up and down. We, as of course, responsible developers, are not in the business of speculating, so we would always hedge. But when, let's say, there is a land delay, there are regulatory delays in getting a, let's say, tariff adoption, etc., these further delay in your forex cycle. Maybe you have to extend your hedges, you have to roll over your call options, whatever you have taken. This further adds cost to it. Number two, the module itself has become it's a commodity today. Mahapatra just mentioned that in case, you know, the China policy is good, suddenly the price is going up. Or if China policy is bad, the pricing will come down. So we have to, you know, we are working ourselves as developers also on very wafer thin margins, or let's say lower competitive IRRs. So this is again a big concern. And related with that, I mean, to say some of the issues which we have faced, for example, imposition of safeguard duty. Now this was a big, although MNRE came with clarification, there will be pass-throughs. Fortunately, recently MERC has announced a favorable decision in case of few projects in Maharashtra. There are cases with CRC which should be announced very soon. But this precedence or this announcement should be made upfront. Like we'd have for our own case, we have done Reva project. We would have paid more than 200 crores of safeguard duty already. Now, when it will be given? Once CRC gives the decision, whether it will be lump sum payment or it will be passed through, how will it happen? It's a big drag on any investor to bring that additional equity and pump it up. So that's another factor. Then, you know, GST was another factor, which fortunately there are a lot of favorable precedents now. So DISCOMs are making it, trying to do it lump sum payments. Some like MP, because of their innovative structuring, will be able to give you lump sum payments, whereas other DISCOMs can't afford to give you a lump sum payment. So now people are going again to the regulator saying, please, instead of lump sum, make it to a tariff pass-through, right? So I'm just trying to say that from a developer point of view, GST you pay upfront, safeguard you pay upfront, your lenders would say your debt equity is structured in a particular manner, so you are putting additional equity. It is a big drag, and whether you're going to be compensated for carrying cost, which has not been addressed so far. These are some very relevant things. Everyone in India wants the lowest tariff. Everyone looks at 244, which is great. Yeah, but we have to be mindful of this, that these are risks which are with developers. And as Mr. Srivastava mentioned, that these distribution of these risks very clearly upfront is so important. If we want this journey to be carried, on one side we like to cap tariffs, then we cancel tenders if we are not happy with the price discovery. So, you know, so there are great things about this sector, but these are challenges which we need to address on the policy front very, very clearly.